See, well, I started guitar, I guess, when I was around 15 years of age. But before that, I kind of dabbled in on the drums and percussion, piano, just fooling around mostly. But I didn't really get serious until I picked up the guitar. Don't know why I picked the guitar up. It was just kind of lying around my living room. It wasn't like I had a love for the instrument or anything. It was just more. He was sitting there, and it wasn't like I heard Jimi Hendrix, and that's what I wanted to do. I was just, yeah. So anyway, it was a beat-up, cheap guitar in my living room, an acoustic thing, and I just started learning chords out of a book and playing drums at the same time in high school. And then I showed my brother Mark, who you might know, he lives in London, well, used to live in London. Started playing the drums. A friend of mine, bass player. Showed me some chords, he played bass, we went to the talent show, started playing, started taking lessons after that. And the rest is history, I guess. I went to New York University to study music in the late 80s when I got there from. I got to New York 84 and graduated in 87 and started playing with Steve Coleman around that time. And then started meeting more people after that.
But when you started actually playing music and going and touring around, I mean, how did you see the music business? Did you really want to be involved in creating music, or was it other things that?
Yeah, I mean, I just
people, you know, there are musicians that have this that attracts them to the business, to the business or whatever you want to call it, and there are others they have, you know, I don't know what other things that.
Women.
Exactly.
Money,
that's the one I didn't want to
drugs.
Miss. Right. You know.
No, it wasn't any of that, really. It was actually music. No, I mean, I just wanted to play music. I mean, I just loved, you know, my heroes growing up in high school. You know, I wasn't into jazz at first. You know, I was like into funk and R&B, James Brown and Parliament Funkadelic, Bootsy.
Yeah.
You know, that was the kind of
good
music.
Stuff.
Even disco music I was into, you know, some rock. I got into rock. I learned about Led Zeppelin and those guys in college. And, you know, Gina Vanelli. I mean, I just, you know, when I got to school, it just opened a floodgate.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I just love music and I love performing. You know, it's just so much fun to, you know, make sounds out of this instrument and express yourself. So, that's my reason for getting into music, you know. And unfortunately, as it becomes more of a profession, it becomes often harder to stay true to that original purpose. And so that's something that I think almost every musician at some point has to grapple with, you know. You make a record and you think, gosh, maybe I should put something for the, you know, commercial in there, you know, for appeal or whatever, and that kind of stuff. And, you know, but I've been very fortunate to be able to do what I do and stay true to what I like to do and make a living doing it. I mean, I do other things. I teach. I teach at Berkeley these days, in Boston, and things like that. And I've been active as a sideman, and I like doing sideman work a lot because I like to play, you know, other different styles of music and everything. So. And only really, I think recently now, am I starting to do my own music as a primary
point.
So it's exciting at a tender young age of 45. You know, there are horror stories and then there are better stories than that. And then there's ones that are, you know, I've never personally had experience with a major label. I can only go by stories of my colleagues and stuff, and there's numerous ones, and you know, where they just don't get royalties, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So when I made my first CD, I decided to, this was at the point, like 2000, where really, you know, the record industry started, the sales started crumbling, you know, and you know, nowadays, it's so easy to put out a record now, you know, on the internet, and end up making more money than you would at a label, you know, and plus you have 100% ownership and control of it. So that's kind of where I'm at now, you know. My last record I did with Robbie Coltrane's label, RKM, so he financed it, put it out, and did his own distribution and everything. So it is nice, it is a lot of work to do on your own, you know. I mean, you can hire people, you know, you can do it any number of ways.
Yeah.
And so I like the concept of artist-run labels, and the next CD that I do will be probably either on RKM or talking to Greg Osby has a new label with a bunch of new artists, so we're talking about doing something. Mm-hmm. So I like the concept of artists helping other artists and working with other artists. Yeah. You know, Artist Share is another label. So I mean, you know, the resources are there. It's easy. You know,
popping up all the time.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's easy to record a record and press it. You know, biggest cost is probably paying sidemen if you're fair, and then the marketing and promotion of it. You know, and there's companies that do that. You know, DL Media. You know, I talk to some companies about it, and you know, you just have to budget yourself and give yourself a time frame to do it. Mm-hmm. You know, and just do it. So, you know, having said that, of course, you know, Blue Note Records called me, you know, and signed me up, I probably would do it. You know, because, hey, you know, this Blue Note. I mean, that's one of the few labels that's there. You know.
Yeah.
Of course, I'd love to do that, but you know, there's sacrifices, to, you know, pluses or minuses to everything, you know. So, you know, I've sort of been on the sidelines, and like I said, now I'm sort of starting to put out my own things and put my stuff out there now.
Yeah.
Well, it was in a band called Lost Tribe for a couple of years. That was with me, Adam Rogers, Dave Binney, Fema Ephron, and Ben Porowski. Did a couple of records. Tree Lock Gertu, of course.
Oh, yeah.
I worked with Tree Lock on a couple of records and tours. And, you know.
How's it working with Josh Stone?
It was fun. It was a lot of fun. Yeah, that was something I've never done that kind of extended
mainstream.
Pop. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Mainstream. I never did that before. So that was a very interesting experience. A lot of drama in the pop world.
Yeah.
As opposed to, I mean, I thought the jazz world was bad enough.
Yeah,
but,
You
know, but she's a sweetheart. She's an absolute sweetheart and an incredible talent.
Mm-hmm.
She's the real deal, you know. Mm-hmm. So I really, you know, it was enjoyable because, you know, if she wasn't that, if she were, I'm not going to name names, but someone who didn't have talent, let's say, you know, propping them up, you know, I would have felt much differently. But she really propelled the band. I mean, she just had a really strong aura, strong spirit.
Yeah.
And, and it's just a really sweet young lady, you know.
She's from England, isn't she?
Yeah, from Devon, yeah.
Yeah.
So that was a great experience. It was a lot of fun. I learned a lot from that and got some endorsements out of it. So that was good. Oh, yeah, you know, you could be playing with, you know, Wayne Shorter and all these great jazz artists and not get anything. And then you do one pop gig and all of a sudden they roll out the red carpet, you know. So it's kind of crazy. But I've never been, like, you know, one of those aggressive cats, you know, to get all the endorsements and stuff. Some people are really good at it. I just, you know, I find something I like, I just stay and play it, you know.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
But, yeah, you know, got some strings that last me for a while, so.